and Allah will give him 10 times reward for the wealth which he has spent. Similar statement you will find in the writings of Imam Ibn Kathir and many great Imam. Imam Shah Waliullah Dehlavi wrote enormously about it, and in his Fuzul Haramain, which is based on his spiritual unveilings in Mecca and Medina, he writes that how he attended these sessions and what kind of spiritual openings took place when he participated in these events. In fact, one person asked Imam Shah Waliullah that what is the dalil or proof of celebration of Mawlid, and he said that for past 500 years all ulama in Mecca and Medina have been celebrating it, and that is enough proof for us that there is no one, whether Hanafi or Shafi or Maliki or Hanbali, all of them have been unanimous in celebrating the Mawlid of Prophet. Imam Shah Waliullah's father, Shah Abdul Rahim al-Dehlavi, who was also a great alim and saint, he says in his writing, which Imam Shah Waliullah quotes in Al-Durrus Sameen fi Mubashirat al-Nabi al-Amin, he says that during the days of Mawlid, I used to prepare enormous delicious food for the people to come and eat. And he says, one year I was very poor and I did not have resources and did not know what to do. So the only capacity I have is that I found some chickpeas, roasted chickpeas, okay? And I distributed on the Mawlid those chickpeas. And he says, that night I saw Prophet in the dream, and he said that Abdul Rahim be accepted. So Mawlid is not something which is innovation or bid'ah, but it is something which is the tradition of Islam, continued throughout centuries, from earlier centuries down to our own day, until these corruptions came and they started to challenge and question the authentic, continuous practice of Muslim Ummah over many centuries. When we look into the Quran Kareem and the Sunnah of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we find that everything which has a relationship with Prophet, it carries a certain barakah and blessing. In the story of Hazrat Yusuf Alayhi Salaam, when Hazrat Yaqub alayhi salam becomes blind, and brethren of Yusuf, they reach to the court of Yusuf, and when they are coming back, Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam says that, take my this shirt and place it in the face of my father. Now this is Quran, it's not a Sufi story. That if you place this shirt on the face of my father, you will see that his eyesight will come back. And Quran says, فَلَمَّا أَنْجَعَ الْبَشِيرُ وَالْقَاهُ عَلَىٰ وَجْهِهِ فَرْتَدَ بَصِيرًا, that when the giver of good news came And he placed this shirt on the face of Yaqub alayhi salam. Then his eyesight came back. Now, what is there in the shirt? Why did Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam did not say that ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly? Of course, he knew Tawheed. Hazrat Yaqub knew Tawheed. And he would have said, what is this shirt? Don't go into these superstitions. Ask Allah directly. He could have said that. Nobody could have stopped him from saying that. But Tawheed of Anbiya and Sahaba and Awliya is different than the Tawheed which is current in our time and age, unfortunately. That is the tragedy. When Prophet ﷺ conquered Mecca and he destroyed all the idols, all the stones which Meccans gathered and placed them inside the Kaaba. But there was one stone which he did not destroy. In fact, he placed it inside Kaaba, in the courtyard of Kaaba, and he asked us that we should pray next to this stone. And that is Muqam Ibrahim. وَاتَّخِذُوا مِن مُقَامِ إِبْرَاهِيمُ مُسَلَّمُ. Now what is in that stone? Why that stone is important? Why we should pray next to a stone? But Prophet ﷺ preserved that stone because it was this stone on which Ibrahim ﷺ stood. Now, of course, Ibrahim ﷺ stood on many stones. If he moved from Iraq to Mecca, there are many stones where he placed his foot, his feet. But this particular stone was important because when Ibrahim and Ismail alayhi salam finished the building of Kaaba, it was this stone where he was standing and he was praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that the future prophet should belong to his family. And when he finished the building of Kaaba, his dua, what was the reward? And what was the ajr he was asking from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The ajr he was asking was that, oh my Lord, that prophet which will emerge at the end of the circle of revelation, that prophet should belong to my family. رَبَّنَا وَجْعَلْنَا مُسْلِمَيْنِ لَكَ. Okay, our Lord. Now he made clear that I am Ismail's generation, not the generation of Ishaq. Two. He mentioned we too. وَجْعَلْنَا مُسْلِمَيْنِ لَكَ وَمِنْ زُرِّيَّتِنَا أُمَّةً مُسْلِمَةً. And in my future generation, a community which is always Muslim. Which is always Muslim. وَأَرِنَا مَنَاسِكَنَا وَتُبْ عَلَيْنَا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ رَبَّنَا وَابْعَثْ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا. That in my future generations, the generation of Ismail and Ibrahim, there should always be a group which is Muslim. Always. And that prophet should be born in that Muslim community. Now this ayah also tells us that the parents of Prophet and grandparents and grandparents, they belong to Ummat-e Muslima. This is Quran. Okay? Ummat-e Muslima, which Ibrahim alayhi salam prayed. and Prophet.